Imagine you're playing the simple game with me, where you flip a coin repeatedly until you get your first heads. The amount I give you depends on the number of flips. With each additional flip, your payout doubles. And in general, if it takes n flips to get a heads, you win 2 to the n dollars. Now, assume I can never run out of money. How much would you pay to play this game? So this is a famous problem called the St. Petersburg Paradox. It's considered a paradox because the math shows huge potential winnings, but it doesn't seem impressive in practice. This is because you've got a 50% chance of getting heads on the first flip and only winning $2. And with a quarter chance, it takes you 2 flips to get that heads, and you'll only make $4. Overall, there's a 97% chance you'll walk away with $32 or less. And only a 1.5% chance you win more than $100. But on the other hand, when you calculate the expected value, or your long-term average winnings for this game, the numbers are astronomical. There's a 1/2 chance of winning $2 plus a 1/4 chance of winning $4 plus an 1/8 chance of winning $8, and you continue this, you can see that this simplifies to an infinite sequence of 1s, so your expected value is infinite. If your long-term average winnings is infinite, shouldn't you be willing to pay any price to play this game, like $1 million? You're a mathematician, so you're very convinced with the expected value calculation. After hearing about this game, you immediately sell your car for $30,000. Now, I charge $30 to play this game each time, and I'm very generous since the expected value is infinite. You think this is the best deal of your life, so you just pay the $30. In your first game, you get tails on your first flip and heads on your second flip, so you get $4. A little bit disappointing, but it's the first game. Over the next few games, you still don't really make much money, but you continue because you trust the expected value calculations. And you think that you just need to play enough games and sooner or later, you'll make a ton of money. After about an hour of flipping coins, you get a huge payout by flipping tails 12 times in a row, where you made $8,192. But you quickly lose that money, and at the end of 2100 games, you basically have no money left and you can't play this game anymore. So overall, you lost $30,000 on a game with an infinite expected value. It's kind of puzzling, but you suspect maybe you didn't start with enough money. So you decide to sell your house for $3 million and go all in on the St. Petersburg game. You suspect the first time you just couldn't play the game enough times, so with $3 million, you'd have to make money, right? With the same $30 cost to play this game, after 2 days of no sleep where you played this game 100,000 times, you're down to around $1.58 million. So in total, you lost $1.41 million. If expected value is actually infinite, how can you be down so much money after playing so many times? You start to question what expected value means. Is it really your average winnings? If so, how can this be infinite? After all, average winnings is just the total winnings divided by the number of times we play, and total winnings is a finite number. If we actually plot our average winnings as we play these 100,000 games, you can see that it's not infinite, of course, but it does seem to be increasing very slowly over time. If we repeat this for other runs, it seems to verify that the average winnings is increasing. This is actually what an infinite expected value means. It means the average winnings will increase without bound, but it says nothing about how fast it's increasing. For the St. Petersburg game, it increases very slowly. It would be very nice if we could derive a function that can predict the average winnings based on how many times we play. For example, if the function can estimate that when we play 65,000 times, we'll win about $18 on average, then paying $30 to play this game seems really high. With this function, one thing we can do is guess how many times we will play this game and then estimate a fair value to pay. To estimate this function, imagine we play the St. Petersburg game 64 times. So each of these squares represents a different game. Each time we play, the winnings are random. But on average, most of the winnings are low amounts like $2 or $4. Remember that we had this pie chart earlier, which gave the distributions of possible winnings. So if we had to guess how much we'd win in these 64 games, we would guess that roughly half of these games give us $2. And then another quarter of these games give us $4. 8 of these games give us $8, and so on. Now, there's one game remaining that corresponds to this white area, which are all the rewards that are $128 and bigger. This could be a huge number, but we can conservatively estimate it at $128. If we add up all these winnings, we end up with a total of $512. This gives us an average payout of $8 per game. We can do the same thing if we play for longer as well. Here we have 256 games. We can estimate this distribution of payouts the same as before. And our estimated total winnings is $2,560, which gives us an average payout of $10 per game. So going from 64 games to 256 games only increased the average payout by $2. This is a very slow growth, and we can estimate this growth in general. When we played 64 games, which is 2 to the power of 6, our estimated average payout was $8. And when we played 256 games, which is 2 to the power of 8, the estimated average payout was $10. In general, if we play this game 2 to the power of s times, we'll make, on average, s plus $2 per game. Written slightly differently, if we play t games, the average payout will be around log base 2 of t plus 2. So the payout is growing logarithmically. But note that these are just intuitive estimates. This isn't a rigorous proof by all means. However, this estimate does seem quite accurate. Now, let's try playing the St. Petersburg game a million times across multiple different runs. You can see that there's still a lot of variance in the average winnings, even at the end of a million games. But this is because there's always a small chance you'll see a huge payout, so it can't really converge nicely to a function. This log function does seem like a good fit. It can actually be proven rigorously that the average winnings will converge to log of t. So in a sense, the log function gives a fair price to play this game. Now, for the $30 that I charged for this game, how many times would you expect to have to play this game to see some kind of profit? Well, if we use this function as an estimate and solve for t, we need to play this game roughly 2 to the 28 times, which is roughly 268 million times. So if we play one St. Petersburg game per second, at that rate, it will take roughly 8.5 years before we see a profit. Whether or not you should play this game at a $30 cost depends on whether you have 8.5 years to waste. But in addition, you also have to consider the chances that you'll go broke playing this game. Remember when you put in $30,000 the first time, you quickly ran out of money. The likelihood of running out of money is called the gambler's ruin problem. I didn't talk about it too much, but in real life, you have to consider this. Also in real life, you might need to ponder these philosophical questions like, does money make me happy? In the St. Petersburg game, there is a chance you can make 2 to the power of $50 and 2 to the power of $51, which are both larger than the entire world GDP. For most people, there's no practical difference between these two numbers. The original solution to this problem, and also the most popular solution to this day, is to use a function that maps your net worth to your happiness. So the y-axis is like the amount of happiness points you have, which economists like to call utility. This function is called a utility function, and everyone's utility function for money is different, so this is a little subjective. But the main property of this function is that if you have $100,000, adding another 100k will make you much happier than if you had 500k and added 100k. So your happiness doesn't increase as fast. The idea was to convert these dollars into happiness points. Of course, exactly how much happier you get depends on your utility function and your net worth. So this is just an example. And then we just find the expected gain in the happiness instead, which tends to be a finite number, and this sort of solves the paradox. But in my opinion, this isn't a real solution because we can imagine a modified game where your happiness points always double in each round. But then, this just becomes the original St. Petersburg game. So a utility function alone doesn't really solve the underlying problem. If you ever encounter a real-life St. Petersburg game, you should probably combine our log function estimate with a utility function to make some kind of a rational decision. If you do know of a better solution, please comment below and let me know. If you like this video, please like and subscribe. I'll see you next time.